Sneak Preview. BioChannel brings you face to face with fascinating people. These guys sang A Fun in the Sun till Daddy took the T-Bird away. In reality, Jan and Dean and Brian Wilson's lives were no day at the beach. Now, surf's up with Jan and Dean.
Two girls for every
was the sound of California dreams, of endless summers and perfect waves, where the girls and boys were blonde, brown, and never had jobs. For a fleeting moment, Jan and Dean lived their own kind of California dream. Even quicker, it was gone. But no one wanted to believe it. Born in Los Angeles just a year apart, in 1940 and 41. Dean Torrance lived an utterly normal middle-class childhood, cared for by parents who loved him. Jan Barry's life was exciting from the start. His mother, Clara, came from Norway, and his father, Bill, helped Howard Hughes build the plane no one said would ever fly, the Spruce Goose.
Gunned the Giant up to 100 miles per hour, then unexpectedly took to the air, flying about a mile at an altitude of 70 feet.
His father must have given Jan a sense of adventure. At the age of three, perhaps thinking he too could fly, Jan fell out of his mother's car while she was driving.
And he had a big gash on his forehead, one on his chin, and I rode in the ambulance with him. And I was, of course, crying, big tears. And he looked at me and he says, "Don't cry, Mommy." And that really touched me.
Most of my youth, we used to play in the 20th Century Fox lot. And that was our playground. Every weekend was climb over a fence and over the barbed wire.
That was about as daring as Dean Torrance would get. Only school could bring such different personalities together as Jan and Dean. They both attended University High School, its student body made up of children of the rich and famous, or those that would become rich and famous themselves. They included Nancy Sinatra, James Bruderlin, who would change his name to Brolin, and a girl named Kathy Koner, whose adolescence inspired the character Gidget.
Everybody looked great. We wore these Letterman sweaters or these club jackets that they still make with the two-tone things with the leather sleeves. And it was kind of pretend tough, but kind of really innocent and wonderful.
Innocent and wonderful bored Jan Barry. While Dean earned gold stars for never missing class, Jan liked to stage fights in the hallways, and when he was missing class, steal hubcaps.
You know, no authority figures would have any power over him, and he would do anything he could to fight the authority. He stole a rifle from the ROTC, and the FBI was snooping around. He punched a cop, and said, and Jan was, he was a tough guy.
Tough, cocky, reckless, and one of the most popular kids in school. Dean Torrance met Jan Barry when they both tried out for the football team.
I almost immediately liked him. And from what I understand from him, he liked me for whatever reason. He had lots of friends. I didn't have quite as many friends as he did. He was in a big, group of people.
Jan was a leader in a gang of middle-class rebels called the Barons. But unlike Barry, most defied authority only so far as what music they listened to.
We kind of listened to the music our parents told us to listen to. Please listen to Patti Page. But we were really checking out Elvis, but definitely Little Richard, rhythm and blues and doo-wop, and that shaped our music.
We'd go to the music stores, and Jan would pick a record that he liked and put it in a little slot, And then I would go talk to the owner of the music store, and into the Barons, our club jacket, they would go. So Jan moved from hubcaps to music.
Barry also moved to San Francisco shortly after his 15th birthday and told no one. He changed his name to Jim Arnold and dyed his hair using black shoe polish.
You know, and he was gone for a couple of months. A couple of months, I wouldn't be gone for a couple of hours. You know, a couple of months.
A few months later, one day I was driving along the road toward home, and I see this figure in my mirror. I recognized him, and I stopped, and when he came up to the car, I said, "You want a ride?" And that's all.
Jan was an incredible risk taker, and this worked for him and against him.
Barry had a ukulele when he was 5 and was fond of playing Little Brown Jug. He hadn't sung in any glee clubs. How he became a serious musician seemingly overnight, no one can say for sure, including Jan. In the absence of hard evidence, there are only stories.
And we went to Wallach's Music City one day, and Ricky Nelson was in the store. And I could see it. Jan looked at Ricky Nelson and he said, I could see it at the wheels turning. He said, "You know, if he can do it, I can do it."
You know, in our locker rooms at University High School.
And the showers had great echo. I mean, it had all that tile.
You know, with all that reverberation, you could do the doo-wop stuff, and if you were bad, you sounded good.
Jan was always one to take it to the next level. We were all content with singing in the showers.
At our home in Bel Air, he basically himself converted the garage to a recording studio.
He got together with Dean and some other guys in our high school club, Jimmy Brudelin, now James Brolin, and some of the other guys, and they formed a group called the Barons West LA, and they started singing some of the R&B favorites like Get a Job and The Still of the Night, and performing at school.
I want to play you a record done by a group called the Barons. First you'll hear There in the Night.
I was sitting at home.
Fake radio station called K-Jan, and the purpose of K-Jan was stationery and everything done in print shop at school was to send letters to labels for them to send to K-Jan all the newest promotional recordings.
We ended up with about 8,000 records from record companies.
So Jan had every recording on the planet.
Dean Torrance's music career appeared to end when he graduated from high school and enlisted in the Army Reserve.
So I joined up. And again, I don't know how I made that decision, because that doesn't sound like me. I mean, most of the young people I knew were just as happy to put everything off and worry about it later. As it turned out, it was one of the smartest things I ever did.
Meantime, his high school friend, Jan Barry, appeared to be living a charmed life.
There was a time when on Bristol Circle, right off of Sunset, where Jan was in a drag race with, I think it was Ryan O'Neill, and they were drag racing down Bristol, which had circles and circles, and Jan hit one of the circles, flipped over 3 times, gets out of the car, walks away untouched.
As Dean Torrance packed his bags for boot camp, Jan prepared to embark on a musical odyssey that would begin in his parents' garage.
More about Jan and Dean when our Bio Channel sneak preview continues. Tonight, we're about pop music personalities. Tomorrow, who knows? Nobody gets personal with the famous, the infamous, and the simply fascinating like we do. Call this number now and tell us you're interested in Bio Channel.
Dean Torrance began serving his 6 months of Army Reserve duty at Fort Ord, California. Back in Los Angeles, high school pal Jan Barry, often joined by fellow members of their gang, the Barons, made music in his parents' garage.
One night, a number of the Barons went down to the New Follies burlesque house, where there was a stripper named Jenny Lee, the Bazoom girl, and we saw the show, The next day, Arnie Ginsberg, who was a club brother, came up to the garage and said, Jan, I have this idea for a song. Jenny Lee. Hey, let's just write this song.
Jenny Lee, Jenny Lee, Jenny Lee.
Jan wanted the song played at a school party, so he and Don went to a Hollywood recording studio to transfer their tape to an acetate disc.
And Jan just lit up. You just saw this whole transformation. He became intrigued with the knobs, the dials, the buttons, the sounds, the things he could do. So instead of just making a straight transfer, Jan fiddled with this for a couple of hours. So throughout the studio, with the door slightly ajar, you could hear bop, 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 bop. And just like a storybook, a guy comes running in the room and says, that's a smash hit record, I want that.
Producer Joe Lubin of Arwen Records bought the song, punched up the recording with some instruments. Then in April of 1958, he released Jenny Lee, performed by the group Jan and Arnie.
Two months later, I hear the damn thing on the radio. I thought for sure I'd absolutely made the wrong choice and missed it. You know, missed it all.
Although Jenny Lee reached number 8 on the charts, Arnie Ginsberg pulled out of Jan and Arnie after only a few months.
At the time, he wanted to just, you know, do something else and maybe not take whatever Jan was, you know, dishing out.
Three weeks after returning from the Army Reserve, Dean Torrance ran into his high school friend at a sandlot football game. Jan invited him back to the garage to hear his latest work.
And then driving up to Jan's house, I thought, well, no, maybe he had a fight with Arnie, and maybe he killed Arnie. And maybe Arnie's up at the house. He's taking me up to that. I couldn't figure out how I could be so lucky that this would just fall in my lap. And he'd take me up there. Then he'd let me go in the playroom. Arnie's body would be there. Then he'd run and call the cops. And who else, you know, would want Arnie gone but me? You know, I'd be the prime suspect.
When we cut Baby Talk, it was just piano and vocals that we did in Jan's garage. And a lot of the things that we did, we just didn't know any better or any worse. You know, it was out of instincts.
They arrived with these blonde hairs in the middle of urban Philadelphia, and the girls went crazy. They were from California.
Pretty much everybody in music, pop music or rock and roll, that youth-orientated music was 5'8" Italian. It was Frankie Avalon and Fabian and Paul Anka. And here come, you know, Jan and Dean, 6 feet, 6'1", looking like they couldn't believe it. I mean, they thought, oh my God, what has happened here?
He was singing lead on all the songs, and Dean was singing background parts with him, but pretty much Jan was in charge of everything that went on in the studio. They weren't good singers. The records were productions. They were the sum of all those parts put together, the tracks and then the lead, and then all those harmony voices and things put on top. That's what made them what they were.
Jan progressed immediately. I mean, he went from somebody that was, you know, playing garage piano to being able to arrange for a full orchestra, eventually doing a lot of producing.
The thing that was exciting about working with Jan and people like Jan was that the music had a more complexity to it and was much more challenging as a recording engineer. It was much more challenging to get